music up, it's not really, you don't have to stop there. It's not like a little fence that you have to climb over or anything like that. Basically, you just get to that line and carry on, but it just measures it out into sections of four. Okay, and so we're just going to go, we're going to strum the A7 four times, and then we're going to move to the D7 four. And we're just going to go through that quite slowly at first. Just making sure that you are getting your fingertips on the notes and getting a nice clear sound. E7, then the D7, then back to the A7 and the E7 again. Okay, so that's what we're going to do first. I'm going to put a metronome on because this is one of the things that we should be doing really is learning how to play a different tempi. This is about 84, yeah. That's 80. We'll just try it at 80. Can you all hear that metronome? No, needs to go up a bit, yeah? Okay. I'll tell you what. Can you hear it now? Is that better? Yeah, okay. How's that? Yeah. Okay. So keep in time with the metronome. Try and get used to that. It's the musician's friend. That's what I call it. Yeah. Okay. If you can't hear the metronome and it's disappeared, it means you're playing in time. Yeah. Okay. So after four, one, two, three, four. Now then, anybody find any benefit in that, in practicing that? Anybody find it a little bit difficult? Are we on, some people I know from past weekends who probably find that quite easy, but sometimes just doing something simple like that, focusing back on it, going back to what you were doing as a beginner, you can sometimes forget. Some of the problems that you can have, like strumming five strings on the A7, four on the D7, and getting it nice and tidy, although it's easy in trying to get it tidy. So let's go to section two now. And on section two, we're going to move up to the fifth and seventh fret bar chords there. So hopefully everybody's got that in front of them. Okay, bar chords. Well, one of the problems with the seventh type bar chords I find is this note here, on the D string. So you're holding a bar like this. If you just go across that bar and play each string individually like that, and see if you can hear the clarity in each one and the evenness of the tone. So you're looking for even tone all the way across. Okay, sometimes this happens when the finger's a bit too far up, you get this kind of thing. You hear that, and you just, sometimes that happens, you know. So the key to doing that is to make sure that this little joint here, where the joint is a little bit away from that fourth string, you know, the D string. So the good thing to do is to pull the finger a bit further down this way, so that you can feel that the joint isn't really over the string, it's in between the middle two strings. So you get that joint in between the middle two strings. Even just starting off like this, if you're doing a new type of chord, a new bar chord, go across like that and see if you're getting the pressure right. Rolling the finger back a little bit to get it straighter, just turning, it's like sort of rotating it back a little bit, that helps. Okay, and see what if you're getting that nice sound. Okay, now we're going to just do a simple, again, just keeping it simple on the A7, D7 and E7, but this time using bar chords, yeah? So let's try that. I'll stick the metronome on again. Okay, ready? After four. One, two, three, four. Screen there, although I can't really hear what everybody's doing, but some people are doing something completely different, but that's fine. If you find this really easy, well, yeah, you can kind of do something a little bit different, maybe a bit more you know, on the rhythm side, you could maybe add a little bit of rhythm. That's a good thing to do. And then one or two people didn't follow the sequence, and sometimes we're on the E7 there, and one or two were still on the D7, not many. So we're going to practice it a little bit more just to get used to that.
Gary, quick question. Can you put a sus4 in on a seventh chord here and there in the blues or not?
If you want to, you can, yeah. Okay. But that's kind of works better on the five chord, you know.
On the five chord, okay.
Yeah, so if you're doing like a... And then when you come up with the... You do the five chord like this. Works good on the five chord. Yeah. If you've got your chord dictionaries out there, you can look that one up. So it also works as an 11th chord like that. Some of these chords, if we, I'll talk about them later, and you can maybe, if you've got the Robin Ford rhythm book or something like that, we can go through a few things from that. Yeah, have you got that handy, Ronnie? If you haven't, I can get it when I take my wellness break halfway through this lesson. Okay, folks, now then, so yeah, quite straightforward, simple chords, but some of the things that I haven't really written down that we will cover in, say, the second and third lessons. We'll be splitting these chords up into, you know, using some double stops and triads and that sort of thing. And if you're the type of person who already knows that, that's fine. Add that as well if you want. You know, sometimes you can be playing a blues. And you can do... knows the ninth chord, stick the ninth chord in on the D, you know. And then we're going to do this sus chord. So that sort of thing, really, more or less, that's that kind of thing we'll do probably in the next lesson. And if, you know, and I think we could use this lesson to, you know, if anybody's got a burning desire to learn a particular chord or chord sequence, you know, in the blues, it would stick, keeping it to the blues, you know, there's no problem just letting Ronnie know, and then I can maybe put a little bit stuff together, you know, that we can, you know, just some written chords or something like that, and we can go through those. You know, the videos and the tracks are already done, but I'm open to, you know, can write some chord sequences out, that kind of thing, and fire them out to you. It's no problem. Okay, so now then, so we're going to do this rhythm. We're going to change the rhythm a little bit with this one, because obviously we're just sticking to the basics to learn the shapes, you know. So I'm presuming everybody's getting a great sound on these three chords. You know, lovely sound, and that's, you know, getting a nice rounded tone all the way across there, and getting the seventh in. Getting that seventh in there. Now, I don't know whether you can see the screen very well. I can see that there. There's another thing you can do with these chords is just to add this seventh here. You can put that seventh in like that. So you're adding a seventh an octave higher. So there's those little things like that, you know, you can kind of do the seventh chord like this. Add the sixth and the seventh, the flatted seventh like that. You can do that kind of thing. So anything, any ideas that you've got, as long as you're getting the basics, you know, just put some new ideas in there, anything that you can think of. Okay, so we're just going to do... We'll just choose a rhythm, something like this. Unless it's too difficult, we could do something a bit simpler, a bit easier if you like. Maybe, yeah, we'll start off with something a little bit easier now, maybe something like this. Yeah, we'll try that. Yeah, so just put a bit of rhythm into this, stick the metronome on again, and again, it's with this, once you put a rhythm pattern in, it's getting the chord changes really accurate. That's one of the important things. I'm going to up the tempo a little bit. This is 96 beats per minute. Yeah, so 96. Yeah, so we're going to just do something like this. So it'll be 1 2 3 4. There, I'm going to put the tempo up a little bit so I can see you all seem to be finding that quite, you're at the right level for that one. Now then, so I'm just going to do, maybe you will do a similar rhythm, get it as close as you can to something like this, like that kind of thing. So after four, one, 1, 2, 3, 4. Sort of ideas you can put into your practice, you know, push the tempo a little bit as well. That's more a straight rhythm, you know, which suits more of a funky blues. We're going to move on to section three now. And in section three, I've mentioned the 1-4-5 chords, which I also mentioned. I mentioned that in the early part of the lesson. And, you know, it's important to know where you are really in the key. And this is in the key of E. So you've got if you think about the E major scale, it's got the seven notes in it. There's eight there, but the eighth one is a repeat of the first one. So seven letter names, that's called an octave because it's eight notes apart. And then the first chord in the blues, chord one, is built on the first note of the scale. So it's literally like, first of all, it boils down to three notes, really, the triad, the root, third, and fifth there. Okay, but on the guitar, the notes are scrambled all over the fretboard, you know, so you've got the root, third, and fifth. And then you've got this flattened seventh. The seventh note in the major scale is this one, which is called the major seventh. But in the blues, we use the flattened seventh to give it that sort of gritty dissonant sound, if you like. So our flattened seventh in the E7 chord is D. And then you can add the D at the top as well. Put your little finger on there. Like that, yeah. So we're going to just do the open chords at first, and then we've got A7, which we've just done in the last piece. We've got a B7, and I think that chord there, Paul might back me up on this, Paul Hozak, but I'm sure John Lennon and Paul McCartney went all the way across Liverpool to find it. The legend has it that they didn't know B7 and they had to go and watch a skiffle group to find the B7 chord. So don't diss the B7. Okay, so anyway, so we've got those three chords, and we're just going to, again, we'll start off keeping it quite simple. You know, just keep a simple rhythm, just straight fours like this, just to get used to those chords. I'm sure most of you are used to, you know, the A7 and the E7. And then we're going to go to the A7 now. And this gets you used to the 12-bar sequence as well, so that you never really forget it and it feels like it's a natural part of playing. And then B7, and then the A7, and back to the E7, and then go up for the turnaround onto the B7, and then we'll just end there. We'll practice that a few times. Yeah, so it's very important. I often come across this, you know, if I'm teaching somebody or a group of people. There might be one or two people in the group who forget where the first chord of the sequence is, and often the first part of the sequence, they get it right up to the 12 bars. Then on the turnaround, it can be a little bit confusing going back to chord one. And what people often do is they often forget to change to chord four in the second bar of the second time through. And I don't know whether you've noticed that, Ronnie, but I've noticed sometimes that can be confusing because the chords feel, it doesn't feel like it should move, but it does, you know. So outside of the basics, this has got the chord four on the second bar each time. And often I've played this over and over again. As I was saying, the chord four gets missed out often second time. So let's try and concentrate on that. So that's a good exercise for this. Okay, so this time, I'll just count in. We won't use the metronome this time. I'll just give you a tempo and we'll just keep in time with me as much as you can. After four, one, two, three, four. Sweet Home Chicago, that'll be the key that we use, and we'll be we'll be looking at turnarounds. And a few lead breaks and that kind of thing. So this key, getting used to this key, is going to be helpful for you. We'll be doing also a shuffle on there, so you have to be able to do the shuffle in the key of E, you know, which is what we'll be doing as well. Okay, so with that one now, I think what we'll do is we'll just we'll push the tempo a little bit on that one, and we'll do a rhythm pattern. I'll think of a rhythm pattern, and then just get this by ear, really. I've got some written rhythm patterns in the section four of the lesson, which we'll be looking at. Okay, that's maybe a bit too fast. I'll knock it back a bit. That's 104 beats per minute. Something like that. We'll just do that similar to what we did before. One, two, three, four. Swing or shuffle, and we're going to do it a bit like this sort of thing. Okay, like that kind of thing. So just copy that rhythm as closely as you can and just do it your own way. It's your own interpretation, yeah. So when you're ready, after four, one, two, 1, 2, 3, 4. The basic chord progression a little bit more interesting to play, you know. Try moving, you know, just parts of the chord up. We will be doing this in detail, and there's a PDF for this in lesson two, but just for you, you know, it might just prick somebody's ears up, really. Just doing little things like... These are the sort of things that we can do to fill out just a basic chord sequence using some double stops. And three notes here, we're just using this triangular shape here at the sixth and fifth and fourth frets like this. Little things like that, we sometimes call them gospel slides when they're... That kind of thing, yeah, which you'll see on the PDF for the next lesson. Okay, so anything that you think, right, we're doing this basic progression, but I'd like to just stick a few ideas in, feel free, just do that, you know. Okay, so now we're going to move on to the 1, 4, 5 bar chords. Okay, so we're moving up to the 5th and 7th fret again, but our one chord this time is on fret number 7. So we've got the E7 like that, you know. We've got the A7 just at the 5th fret here. Yeah. And then we've got the E7 again, goes back for a couple of bars, and then we go to the B7, just the same shape as the A7 on the 7th fret, and then and back to there. So that covers our 12 bars, yeah. Okay, so we'll do a similar sort of rhythm to what we were just doing just there. You know, it's a little bit like the Sweet Home Chicago rhythm, but slowed down a little bit. Or a little bit like the original rhythm. So just do something like this. That kind of thing, okay? So after 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Back to the 5 chord, then round again. this question quite a lot, you know, about bar chords, how much practice should I do? And I know a lot of people in the class today have done bar chords before, but I think one of the problems with them is if you're practicing them for a long time, that there's a little bit of, you know, discomfort sometimes. And just move, you know, if you're practicing, move off the bar chords and do some open chords, do different things, move around, you know, don't stick to the one thing all the way through, because, you know, you build the strength up better if you do a little bit of each skill, you know. So your bar chords, you can, if you've got a new chord and you're adding that new chord, practice it slowly and just, you know, without playing a piece of music, you know, you might be learning a new chord, a new shape, something like that. And just do it slowly and in a measured way, really. And then if there's any discomfort, just stop for a bit and do something else. Okay, so we've got we've got those E7, A7 chords, that sort of thing. And what we're going to do is we're going to build on those in the second lesson. We're going to do a little bit more. As I was saying earlier, we'll be doing how to fill in around the chords. Yeah. Doing a little bit more of those sort of things. But what I want to do now is move on to section 4. Right. And section 4 has some rhythm patterns. Yeah. Now, what I want you to do is I would like you to have a little go at the first one and just try and practice it without hearing it, if you can. Okay, and that can be quite challenging. See if you can work that out. Did somebody get disconnected there?
Gary, this bit always fascinates me. It's okay just trying to follow you with it, but actually reading it from scratch, I don't know if anybody else has trouble with this sort of thing, just following what's written is written, reading, you know, reading rhythm. Paul's back.
Yeah, you got disconnected, I think, there. Reading the rhythm. So you've got four beats in the bar. On this particular part, the time signature isn't in there, but it would be four beats in the bar, that. So first you've got, let's break it down to something simple. When we first started, we had this pattern, which was just the straight four beats, you know. So we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, like that, yeah. And then if we just half each beat, okay, we end up with 8 strums, you know, so we end up with, and we count that like this, and we just go 1 and 2 and 3 and 4, and it's a really good way to connect your strumming as well, get your strumming in time with the beat, and just, you know, the groove of the music will work much better if you have, you know, the down and up strokes with the plectrum hand, which for most people is the right hand in this class, maybe. I don't think there's any left-handers today. And really, it's important to get that coordination right, I think. So if you're tapping your foot on the beat like that, or you've got the metronome going on the beat, try first of all just playing straight fours like we did at the beginning, and be honest and think, right, did I actually nail those beats, or did I actually sometimes hit them a little bit to the left or a little bit to the right? And sometimes that happens, you know. And then so you've got your foot tapping away, then just maybe add some eighth notes. So maybe you could do something like 1, 2 and 3, 4 and, okay. So you would end up with 1, 2 and 3, 4 and, okay. Now then, these rhythms that are on here are a bit more complicated than that, but if we look at rhythm pattern number 2, we'll see that rhythm pattern number 2 has 2 eighth notes at the beginning, okay, So I don't know how many people have done rhythm courses before reading rhythms, but you've got two eighth notes there. And then you've got this kind of squiggly line, like a seven with a little ornate dot at the top. And that means rest for an eighth of a bar, if you like, or a half a beat. Rest for half a beat. And then you strum just after that. And then you take another rest for half a beat. So that one, I don't know whether you've tried that one yet. Trying number two, you go one and one and four and one and four and one and four and. So you've got one and, then the and of two and the and of three, and then the four and. So it's now, if you have a look at the top, you'll see this, the symbol, it's like a square symbol or, you know, and then you've got the V like that. They come from violin music. The first one is a downstroke and the second one is an upstroke. So the square symbol is a downstroke and the V pointing down at the note is an upstroke. So trying to get those right is really important. So just choose a single note like that and just practice that rhythm. Try and get it nice and accurate. You can play a chord if you like, it's up to you, but I'm just choosing a single note to keep it simple first, so there's no complications in the way. So I'm just going to go. Okay, so you've worked that out, and then play it with a chord. We'll just use an A7 chord for argument's sake. We'll just start with an A7 chord and we'll just go. Now, what's really important about this are the gaps in between the rests, and often what I hear when we're doing this, we've done this at guitar weekends before, and we go round and round it, and then in those little gaps, there'll always be somebody who doesn't release the pressure on the left hand so that the chord disappears or goes silent for that half beat. So how to do that really is to, you're holding the chord down and you just relax the left hand. You don't take it off the fretboard altogether. You just relax it so it's not pulling the strings down onto the chord, and you're just resting on top like that. So you're just resting on top of the strings. That would be what you'd have to do first, like that. Now then, when you make a little mistake on the rhythm and you're playing the rhythm and trying to work it out, you know, often what happens is you might make a mistake on a downstroke, so you go to an upstroke instead, or you do something, you know. So what you've got to do is work out what you're doing. You're back again. So a few problems there. So now we need those little spaces in between, and the spaces are on the second beat and the third beat. So it's just like going one, two, three. So one, two, three, there, that's where the spaces are. One, two, three. So go on. And you can count eight if you like. You can go one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. One, two, three, four, five. So what you want to do is miss out three and five, okay? So you miss out three and five. So you go one, two, two, do, 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 one, two, four, da, 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 one, two, da, 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 like that. And sometimes when I have to read a rhythm, a complex rhythm, what I often do, I'm often reading a bar ahead if I'm doing a piece where there's a lot of reading involved. And I try and sort of vocalize it like that in my head a little bit, you know. So just trying to read it at speed is difficult. But we'll work it out and we'll just go one and four and one and four and one and four and. Okay, like that. And once you get used to it, you'll probably be able to play any speed really and just speed it up. You know, so once you get the accuracy there, you can build that up. Okay, so let's try a 12 bar. In A, okay, we'll do it in A, and we'll use rhythm pattern number two, okay? Rhythm pattern number one was a bit difficult to work out, but I will play it for you, and it's actually on the video as well, so you'll see it on the video. Okay, so right now, so we're just going to be like this in time with the beat, so. And just get a nice choppy feel on the chords as well, you know, leave space in between. You know, you don't, the last thing you want is, because it almost just mushes together a little bit, so we're trying to get it to snap, you know, get the rhythm to snap a bit. So one, two, three, four. Go to a D7. Beneficial exercises playing rhythms. What I would just say is that if you can mix some of these rhythms together, and you can do, you could play rhythm pattern one followed by two or whatever, and mix it and make a composition out of it, compose a rhythm that works, so you're not just doing repetition all the time. So we're going to have a little look at number one now. Okay, number one has a dotted note. So on the first beat, you've got a note with a little dot after it. And that is a symbol that means that you have to hold that for 3/4 of a beat. Yeah, 3/4 of a beat. And then on the next beat, I don't know whether you know where the beats are divided, but you can try and work out where the beats are divided. On the next beat, you've just got what's called a quaver. It's literally just like playing on the second beat, but you're shortening it a little bit because there's a rest after it. So that means just leave a space there. Okay, so leave that space. And then play it on the three and the and. So you're going to go one and, three and, one and. So one, two, three and, one, two, three and. And then on the end there, you've got a little squiggly line there, which is a crotchet rest or a single beat rest. So you rest for one beat there. Okay, so this one sounds a little bit like this. Okay, I don't know whether you've imagined what it might sound like, but if you have, just see if it's anything like this. So it's like, thing. Okay, so that's what we're going to do next. We're going to play that rhythm. Now try and keep it nice and tight. Okay, imagine there's a producer sitting there and you're doing a recording or making a record, and you have to get this perfect. Yeah, it's for Shirley Bassey or somebody like that. Yeah. Okay, so one, let's try that. We're going to do a standard blues like we did before. We won't go to the D7 on the second bar. We'll just keep the A7 going for 4 bars, like a kind of very basic standard blues. After 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. To the D7. Rhythm and rhythm pattern two are on a track that is, you've got the link for it, the link's in the Dropbox, and it's just on my YouTube channel. It's private access only for people on this course. Okay, so it's not a public access thing, it's for you. And then we've got, I've got a little bit of it where I go from rhythm pattern one for a 12 bar, then I go to two and then back to one so you can hear it. And then the, there's this track after it, there's two tracks on the same video. The second track, I just take all the guitars off so that you can practice those rhythm patterns yourself, okay?
And if you I'll tell you what, Gary, I tried that moving from pattern one to pattern two as we went along. It's not easy. It's not that easy.
Not really.
It really isn't that easy.
Not really. Mixing it up is quite difficult. Yeah. Yeah. You could make a good composition out of these four, just these four rhythm patterns, and there's millions more. I mean, some people will remember doing the weekends, and we've got loads of rhythm sheets, and maybe it would be a good idea to give everybody some of the basic ones that are in the Dropbox, you know. I think it might be a nice idea. Okay, so now then, number three. What I might do with this one, right, is not do it exactly the way it's written, but the last four quavers in the bar, we'll do them as mutes or something like that. So we'll do them like this. We'll do mutes like that. So we've got that similar rhythm pattern on the first beat there to number one. So it's like this. That's the first one. Now, the second beat is just straight. Each quaver is even. That's like that. And then what we're going to do on the last four is, so we're going to go like this. So just going to mute the last four, yeah? Because I think it might sound a little bit more exciting, you know, break it up a little bit. Not that there's anything wrong with doing something like, I mean, it would sound a little bit like this. But I'm kind of varying it a little bit and not playing it.
Gary, is this the bar that you wanted to talk about?
It is, yes, it is. Okay. Yeah. It should have, right? Is there a screenshot? Have you... Could I screen share or something? Or?
Yeah, you're a co-host. You can screen share. Right, okay.
I'll see if I can find it. I should be able to find it on here.
It's just the down, up, isn't it? That they need to change your add in.
Yeah. You might, hopefully you can see the iPad screen. All right. Okay. No, you can't. I'll just go to the Dropbox and I'll get it out of the Dropbox.
Can we just annotate it, Gary, or is that...
Well, it's better if you can see it and then...
Okay.
Because it's difficult to explain. So it got that up there. I'll just find the correct page and then I'll share the screen.
Well, do you want me to find it while you carry on?
No, I've got it.
You got it? Okay, great. Yeah,
got it. So... And if you just have a look there, folks, at bar number 51, you'll see the mouse there. There should be a downstroke followed by an upstroke, downstroke, upstroke, and then downstroke, upstroke at the end as well. So if you just write that in, I'm sure you'll be able to hear what I'm playing, but just for reference, also this has been put right and it's in the Dropbox for you. Okay. We used to give people a prize for spotting the mistakes, but then there was too many. So we've given all of our money away. But this is the only one I've found today on this one. Okay, so just make sure that you're doing it like that. Now, so we're going to put mutes on the last four here. Yeah, so it's going to be like this. So like... So controlling the mutes can be difficult, and if you don't get them to sound exactly the same every time, it doesn't matter, because I think it sounds robotic sometimes that way, but you're just looking for a guide, you know, looking for a guide. It's just to give you an idea of what to do. Okay, so let's try that. Sounds are sort of... use that sort of out of phase thing on the Strat, you know, in between the treble pickup and the... middle pickup sometimes for funky sound and stuff. It's quite percussive. Okay, so I'm going to use that. So we're going to just do something like this on a standard blues. We'll just go 1, 2, 3, 4. Thing, I'll put the metronome on. Maybe we'll do this one a bit faster. That's 120. Okay, get used to the metronome, get used to that sound. After four, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. Finish there. Okay, we'll try that one again. We'll do that one again. Now you'd probably be able to fit that one around one of the backing tracks that's in the Dropbox as well.
Gary, some people may not have heard, but I thought you were cutting out. If you unshare the screen, it's probably really better than I think.
Yeah, okay, I'll do that. All right. Okay, no problem yet. It's too much stress, was it, for the program? Yeah, okay. We'll get that full screen now. Okay, let's try that again. Sorry about that, folks. Difficult to hear what's going on at the other end. All hear the metronome okay? I think this one deserves a bit of practice as well, doesn't it? We can run through this one a few times. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. D7. I think that's getting a little bit more technical. Moving on to something that can keep you occupied a little bit, mixing those rhythms. Maybe what you could do is mix rhythms number 1 and 3 or something like that, and do something like. Improvising a little bit around those patterns and making it sound a little bit more funky. Yeah. Okay, and number four, right? This one is a really difficult one to work out, so I am just going to play it for you, really, so that you can hear it. And there's a little clip on, I think I've done a condensed down version of the whole lesson, which is about a 20-minute video, which again, you've got the link for that. And it goes through all of the exercises. And this one, I use a 7-sharp 9, an E7-sharp 9 with this one now. I don't know whether people have come across this chord before. And it's the one that Jimi Hendrix uses on Purple Haze. I'll just come up to the screen so you can see how that, yeah. Better second finger on that 7th fret, index finger there on the 6th, and then 7th fret there, like that triangular shape. This one here, like that. And when it's in E, you can use the low string. You can just play all of the strings because they all fit the chord pretty well, because you've got two E's as well, which is the root note of the chord. Now I'm using sometimes the root note of the chord. I'm not just doing the rhythm just straight on the chord like this, otherwise it would sound something like this. Which is fine, it's fine. I tend to find that I just, when I play this something like this, that I mix it with the root note of the chord as well. So sometimes pluck the chord, maybe pluck the root note of the chord on the first beat like that. So we'll pick strumming a bit. The 1-4-5 in the key of E, and then we're using, sometimes if we can extend the chord a little bit on the B7 as well. And if you're adventurous, you want to do a little bar on the B7 chord like that, you get the Spencer Davis Keep On Running chord at the 7-sharp 9 again, you know. So we're going to do that one, and we're going to do. And on the 2/16ths in the middle of the bar, or on the third beat of the bar, I'm doing a chord and then the. So I'm doing this. Just try and find something that's natural to play that feels a little bit like that. So it's breaking it up a bit. It's a bit different to the others because you've got the bass notes in there as well. Okay. So let's just try that one. Keep it nice and steady, not too fast. And we'll just go around a standard blues progression in the key of E, and we'll stay on the E7 sharp 9 for 4 bars and just follow the standard blues. Okay. So after 4, 1, 2, 3, 4 and. Thank you. lots of things you can do with that one, which we won't do this right now, but there is a little clip of it on the video. And it's just adding a little riff and a bass note in between. And, you know, we'll do stuff that's similar to this in the next couple of lessons. We'll do, maybe do a few rhythm exercises on this. And it's just doing a little riff like this, this type of thing. Okay, so you can, if you, you can hear what's going on there, you can maybe at some point, if you feel like you could be you could practice that, or if it's beneficial. Some people might feel that that's pushing it a little bit too far, you know, on the rhythm side, and maybe keep it as a target for the future. Or if you, you know, if you come back to do another course, then maybe we'll focus a little bit more on that as well, on the rhythm side of blues. Okay, now then, we're going to move on to section five now. Okay, and section five, we look at the scales that we're going to use for some of the improvisation on the next couple of sessions. One that a lot of people do know, but sometimes stumble with the fingering a little bit, is the A blues in the fifth position. And what I would recommend, first of all, if you've never done this before, I can see some people are already playing it and can play probably the extensions as well. But if you've never done this before, just keep it nice and steady and just find the left hand fingering or the fret hand first. Keep it simple with the picking hand, so you're just doing down strokes so that you're not really stressing about alternate picking. Just get used to that left hand pattern and finding the notes. And see if you can do that and play that without, you know, get it to a point where you can play it without leaving any little gaps or anything like that, you know. And then once you've done that and you can do that, get on to alternate picking. Now, some experienced players still struggle with alternate picking. I see some people have been playing for years and years and maybe missed out on it a little bit and maybe fudge over a couple of notes. Sometimes when you get to that G string and going to the B, I see some people doubling up a little bit and dragging across. And it's a good way of eliminating that habit if you have got that habit. And I always find anything that you practice, if you stop and practice rather than just play your favorite songs and you stop and you're looking at how you play, it can really improve how you sound as well. So you're looking at, get it nice and steady, take your time. There's nothing wrong with playing something slowly. So we're going to do it with alternate picking this time. And we go down, alternate down and up strokes like this. So using a freehand pick. So the hand is free. It's not resting on anything. Keeping it steady, trying to get a nice even tone on each of the notes, yeah? And that can be difficult because the bass notes are louder than the treble notes, you know, so getting the evenness across is difficult. I learned that from a book called Perfect Pick Technique by a guy called Ivan Morant, and there was lots of those type of exercises and it was really good. If anybody finds a copy, I'll buy it off them because somebody never gave me mine back when I loaned them it, so I would like to get hold of it again. So that's the blues scale there. Now let's try that, and we'll just try it. This time we're going to try it to a metronome, and this is something that you should use in your practice all the time.
Gary, could I just ask a quick question, very quick question?
Certainly, Doug, yeah.
You just said about leaving the your picking hand free, not resting it on anything.
Yeah.
Is that so? Just clarify that, because I've not been doing that.
Have you not? Right. Well, what it does is, I mean, if you haven't been doing it and you've got a habit that you've been using all your life, I'm not suggesting that you change overnight. First of all, that's what first thing. But it is good for moving freely across and actually keeping in a parallel line as well. You know, perpendicular to the string, and it's just good technique.
Yeah.
You know, nothing's compulsory, but I think it does. It helps with speed, you know, sort of.
That's That's all. That's really useful. Thank you.
Yeah, try that and see.
Yeah, I will. I've already tried it since you've been doing it just now, but a minute ago. But that's really helpful. Thanks.
Yeah, no problem. Okay, so getting back to just doing that alternate picking, find a tempo that suits you. Don't try and push the tempo too far, because that can lead to, you know, in terms of good and bad habits in practice, it's a bad habit. If you do it too quickly, you might fudge over notes, and some notes where the scale's a little bit difficult, you might find that you're not really getting the best tone. So slow it down to a nice tempo where you feel like you can do every note perfectly, get the sound that you want. Now then, for alternate picking, that's 63. It's really hard getting used to slow tempos on a metronome, because we all tend to speed up a little bit, more so when we're playing chords and rhythms, that sort of thing. But alternate picking at 63 might be just about right for some people, so. Something like that to start off with, and if that's too fast, drop it back down. Sometimes what I do is just go to a higher tempo and just play the notes. So, and I might just do it like that, yeah. So the metronome's now playing a quaver beat instead of a crotchet beat. But I'm going to go back to about 66. And I'm going to go get used to the tempo, click it like that a little bit. This is one of the things I used to find difficult when I started recording, was getting the tempo of the piece right at the beginning and getting in on the tempo. I used to always have to warm up a little bit, but using the metronome helped quite a lot. Okay, so get that metronome. 1, 2, 3, and 4, and. Should land on a downstroke when you finish as well. Start and finish on a downstroke on this one. Let's try that again. 2, 3, and 4, and. Okay, now then, other things you can do with that, once you get used to it at that tempo, obviously this is a lesson and practice happens after the lesson. You take it away and you practice it. You, once you've learned how to do that, knock the tempo up, but just do it gradually. Yeah, don't go right, okay, I'm going to knock that up from 63 to 100 or whatever and try doing that. It's good to get the gradual steps in between and just learn the skill gradually. Like anything, don't practice one thing for 5 hours and then leave it for a week and a half and expect it to be good when you come back. It'll be better doing 10 or 15 minutes a day on something like this and doing a little bit, but often. So now, maybe after you've done that, you could do. And double up a bit, and it helps you with your pick technique. You know, so any skill that you can do, once you can do it in a simple way, do something different with the pick in hand, you know? Triplets or something like that, and try different ways. We're not going to do all of those now because we really need to get through a couple of more things before we finish. They're just ideas for you to practice later. Okay, so the next one is the E blues scale. So obviously these scales are all transposable, but this one's in the open position. And the A blues, you can move it up and down and you can play it in different keys. So you just learn that pattern. And if you're doing a blues in B, just move it up to the seventh fret, you know. So that's a little bit of geography of the fretboard, if you like. But this one, E blues, is in the open position, and some of the notes are open strings. So we're just going to try this one slowly. Just have a little look at it. And we'll just try this pattern after four. One, two, three, four. So again, do the same sort of thing that you were doing when we were practicing the air blues. Get the metronome on, do, you know, slow tempo accurately first. Yeah. And a little thing about practice is that, you know, practice isn't always as enjoyable as just playing for fun, but you should play for fun a lot and enjoy it. But you should, when you're practicing, it should be pushing you into areas that you might feel a little bit, oh, I don't feel comfortable about that. Get you out of the comfort zone a little bit and just and work on that a little bit. Yeah. Okay, so now then, after this, we're just going to move on a little bit because we've only got about 15 minutes left and we're going to just go through the last couple of exercises. So scales is something that you should practice and you'll probably will probably do a bit of warm-up on the next two sessions as well. And this is a 12-bar blues shuffle, and one of the problems I often see with this is getting the using the right hand and getting the right sound, you know. Often people will play it and leave it quite open like that. This is just a simple one going from the 5 to the 6. And what I would like you to try and do is use the right hand to mute a little bit. So it's away from, Doug, it's away from that free hand thing with the scale, and it's using the mute, you know, so going back to something that you'd be more familiar with. So you're just going, and I'm using that to mute, you know. And occasionally I might open up some of the notes so that it gives it contrast, you know, so you're not doing the same thing on each note. So you're giving it a bit of dynamic contrast. So this is just going across the A, D, and the E. So 1, 4, 5, shuffle in the key of A. Okay, so just try that one. Any questions, just you can put your hand up and ask them at the end or whatever. If you get stuck, just let me know. I think it should be okay with this. So after four, 1, 2, 3, 4. So now I've used all downstrokes on that one at quite a slow tempo. Now I'm going to just use alternate picking and just listen to the different sound. You can get it. It is a different sound when you use the alternate. So you can sometimes accent the backbeat a little bit more and get a different sound out of it. So it's quite an interesting one to do. So we'll put the metronome on this time. I'm going to use 76. It's kind of slow to medium tempo. After four, 1, 2, 3, 4. Chord. finish on an A chord. Yeah. So try that one both ways with the downstrokes as well to get different tone. And try with the mute so you're getting good control over the notes and the notes are not sort of ringing out too much and you get a nice tight rhythm sound with that one. And then the last thing we're going to do, just going to run through, is it's just a little riff here that we're going to do. So instead of, you know, being focusing on chords quite a bit, this time we're using the pentatonic notes and some of the notes of the seventh chord as well. Okay, so using that, and we're going to use a little slide as well. Now the slide, it doesn't tell you exactly where to slide from, but you slide from the second fret up like that using the third finger. Just it doesn't have to be exactly that. You can just slide it one fret if you like. And just looking at it, so it's from bar 79, and it's based on the A7, D7, and E7 chords again. And there's a little mini turnaround at the end, which is just a shortened version of an E7 chord. Okay, and it's like that kind of thing. You'll see it in the tab. Just look at the tab rather than the chord box on that one. You'll see that it's holding down second fret, first fret, and third fret. And that's an E7 chord, that one. Yeah. Without the fifth. Okay, so what this one, this is a little bit like, it just goes like this. This is the control that you need for to play a riff and then to play a chord at the end is different. Your picking hand has to move to a different position and it's harder to get all of the notes clean. So it's a little riff for you to practice. Okay, so let's try that one again. Put the metronome on. This time, a bit faster, like a boogie. That's 108 BPM, that kind of thing. Okay, so after four, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. See, some people have found it a little bit difficult there to get that first time. So I'm going to drop the tempo down a little bit there. I'm dropping down to 96 and we'll just keep it a bit slower. Just have a little look at that. And sliding up and down those notes as well can be a bit tricky. Okay, let's try that again. After four. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. Thank you. Okay, so I think actually what I did there is I went to chord four on bar two, which isn't written in the sheet, but you can do that. And sorry if I put anybody off, it was meant to, I can't see the whole sheet. I've got to scroll up and down because I've just got the small screen. Okay, now then, quite a bit, you know, some of that, some of the stuff we've done tonight, we started off with some basics, you know, some real basics. And some of the stuff might be challenging for one or two people. And for other people, it might be just preparatory to get them into the groove a little bit for what's coming next. And on the what's coming next is a little bit more of the shuffle. We'll be doing the shuffle, but we'll also be doing some, you know, rhythm comps, you know, instead of just doing the chords, we'll be doing. That kind of thing we'll be doing. Little bits of lead breaks, that kind of thing will come into the next lesson. And a bit more on improvising around the backing track, that kind of thing. So there'll be quite a little bit more in the next lesson and going into a little bit more detail. But putting everything together from the three lessons that we're going to do, it'll give you a good foundation in the blues. And I suppose some people have already played a bit of blues. And, you know, if you like that style and you like playing the blues, you get a lot out of it. Learning to improvise, it never really stops. I always fall back on the blues to go back to getting the chops together if I have to do anything, you know, any gigs or anything like that. It's often the sort of basic thing I go back to, you know, and a bit and some jazz standards and that sort of thing as well. But, you know, that's the kind of thing that can really help you to focus and give you something to learn and get through it. And look at any areas and you think, right, okay, I thought that was easy, but it's actually, I'm not actually doing it the way I thought I was doing it. Because it sometimes gets you to focus on it a little bit when you put that metronome on, and, you know, and hopefully you've got something out of this tonight. And hopefully you'll all be doing next week as well, if you are. If you're not, and you're just going to focus on what you've learned from tonight. All the best with that, and focus on that and try and get yourself up to that next level, and maybe you might want to come back and do the next level some other time, you know.
Gary, are you saying, yeah, you know, when we did the sort of standard blues in the shuffle in A,
yeah,
and then doing all this this riff, is that kind of going into double time, is it? So you could do one whole 12 bar as normal shuffle strumming, maybe with a Hendrix thing or something, and then move into this, which is double time all the way through.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, you can, with this, you can, with this really, you can, what they are really is they're all different parts that could mesh together, really.
Mm.
Because you could have a guitarist doing, and another one doing, you know, and you might have that two different parts on a track, and a bass player going there. So it's kind of separating the parts a little bit. I had quite an interesting conversation with somebody I was teaching the other day who said it's taken me all these years to realize that he was just playing bar chords all the time. He thought that everybody just always played bar chords. And we were doing Sunshine of Your Love, you know. And he thought he'd been... been playing it like that, and then he didn't realize that you had sometimes the single notes and little things like that, you know, little fills, and you just saw it as just chords, big chords really. And some of these parts mesh together, you can separate them out, and you can when you play along with the backing tracks, you can play one part or the other, and you know, you can just mix them together like that, or play along with it on a voice recorder. Put the track on and play on a voice recorder, and you play one of the guitar parts along with it and make a little recording of it or something like that, and listen to yourself. Because most of these things, you can just move them around different keys. So, yeah.
Well, look, should we just do it open very quickly for some last questions, if anybody
has any? Yeah, certainly.
And you've got this Dust My Broom to go away and have a look at yourselves, I think.
Yeah, that's just the exercise number six, section six, just is the rhythm. It's really like the rhythm for the Dust My Broom, which I haven't got on my PDF, but it is on yours.
Yeah.
So that's got a little riff as well, you know, which is just a... It's that kind of thing, you know. Just use as an A chord. So just uses that blues shuffle so you can get through it using that. Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you what, on lesson two, maybe we just spend the first 30 seconds just playing that just to check everybody's okay with it.
Yeah, fine.
You've got lots to do in lesson two, I know. Yeah. Any questions? We're going to call it quits. It's quite late. Oh, yeah. Mike?
Yeah. Are you going to do some blues turnarounds as well?
Yeah, we are, yeah. Mm-hmm. We're going to do quite a few, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And on this Dust My Broom, what's the best version of that to listen to then? The Elmore James version?
Elmore James version, I think. It's got like a nice slide part in it. I like that version the best, but I like to listen to different ones. You know, I do like to go and listen to the originals, the original Robert Johnson versions, just to sort of find out where people got the inspiration from. But the Elmore James is really good. Hound Dog Taylor does a good version as well, worth checking out. Any other questions?
All stunned into silence.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes.
Is that the guys who were looking for the B7 chord? Excellent.
Oh, they found George Martin. They got there in the end.
Yeah, they did. Yeah, they got the chords in the end. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Then they got all the way up to Strawberry Fields. It had about 1,000 chords in it.
Yeah. Right. Should we call it quits then? I hope there's enough to just sort of elementary. Well, actually, it's not elementary stuff. If you're doing it properly, I think it's quite hard. But I'm sure Gary will correct us next time around. So should we say good night? And Gary, thanks for that.
Thank you very much, everyone, yeah.
And I will put the stuff into Dropbox to do with videos and things from Gary, and I'll put stuff up there for lesson two ahead of the lesson so you can have a good look through it. You're okay with that, Gary?
Yeah.
Maybe a day or two before?
I've got the stuff ready for that.
Okay.
I'll probably just tart the videos up a little bit, because we've done this before, and I just would add a few things, you know. I might just do a breakdown video showing you all of the individual parts, which are all on audio tracks, but they're not on video. So I'll do that as well for next week. I can't promise I'll have it done within the next couple of days, but it will be ready for next week's lesson.
No, that'll be fine. That'll be great.
But okay. PDFs are all there. Yeah. Lovely.
Okay.
Thanks very much.
Good night.
Gotta go and watch everything. Thanks,
guys. Okay.
See you next week.
Everybody, see you next week. Thank you very much.
Good night, everyone. Good night. Thanks, Gary. I'll speak to you tomorrow.
Okay, I'll speak to you tomorrow, Ronnie. Thank you.
Yeah, it was good.
Bye now. Excellent.
All right, who's going to be last off?
Should I wait a bit?
Oh, it's David, I think. David or Simon. Yeah. Oh, yeah, David, you're the last one off. I hope, did you find all the PDFs?
I think.
You're muted.
There's only really one anyway for this lesson.
Can you unmute? Do you know how to do that? Just press the little microphone thing.
Mute.
That's it. So you can hear me now. Yes.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah, I did manage to run all that off afterwards.
Good stuff.
I had a chance to have a little look at it, really. But
yeah, I thought I'd send them out by email rather than Dropbox, just to make sure everybody physically had them in their inbox. That's all it was. Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Well, we can have a little look at that now. So that's
okay.
All
right. Well,
I'll be more prepared next time, perhaps.
Oh, what's that?
I'll be more prepared next time, perhaps.
Ah, you did all right. I was looking to you. You seem to be fine on all that.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Okay. We'll see you next week then.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, good night now. See you later.
Stop really hard. Let me stop it.
Where are we? And you're...
No.
That's it. Hang on a minute. Still got somebody on.
Come on.
You've switched your video off, I think, David.
All right.
Yeah, okay. Yeah?
Okay, all done. Lovely.
Good. So, yeah, do you think it went all?
I thought it was really good. Yeah. Just the right pace as well. And I know you. I mean, there was no point going through Dust My Broom because we'd have been rushing it, wouldn't we?
Oh, I think so, yeah.
And it's something for them to do.
It's really just an extra that I threw in, really.
I know.
You know, put it into the context of a song, but when we're not exactly focusing just on the song, we're learning about the basics, aren't we? But there's a song that you can listen
to. I thought, Gary, that was just right, actually. Just, I mean, I could see you going, I bet you everybody's bored with this A7, D7,
that's
E7.
What I was thinking, yeah.
But no, it starts everybody off. And it's great, you know, for people, you know, like hobbyists, like us, like me. Do you feel like you're into it? You know, even if it's simple.
So it just brings you in and synchronizes everybody. Yeah.
And it's great. It's great. And then you bring in the rhythm. And then everybody goes to pot.
Well, maybe so. I mean, on the next one, there's quite a lot on the paperwork for the next one, to be honest.
Okay.
There's loads of stuff.
Would you want to talk through it and make sure we've got some timing right?
We'll do that later. I'll have a quick look through it because I remember doing the Sweet Home Chicago before and we didn't get everything finished.
No.
So I might look at it and maybe if I'll have a look at it tomorrow and I might just cut a few things out and then on some supplementary sheets if anybody says, oh, I need some... more things to do.
I think what you said just now is quite good. If you cut some things out and you left them to the end as, you know, nice things they could work on themselves along with the song in that week.
Yeah.
There's a small video about that with the tab. Then that's up to them to work out because you can't cover everything off. Otherwise, you'll be rushing like mad and then you'll feel under pressure, which is not right.
That's right. I know.
Okay.
Okay, great. Okay.
Gary, have a nice rest now. You're not doing anything else now, are you? Packing up.
Finished. That's it. Switching everything off.
All right, good stuff. Okay, cheers, Gary.
Nice one. See you.
All right, take it easy.